Aloha, I'm Auntie Dale, Castle 78.
I'm Pastor Ron, Castle 71.
And we are the Kane Ohe Crew. We want to welcome you to our online platform.
Right now, here's a special message by Pastor Daniel. Check it out.
Hey everyone, it's so good to be here with you. Today we're actually starting a new mini series called Emotional Health. We'll see how long this series goes actually. And I say that in all honesty because I really feel the Holy Spirit on this series, and I was originally planning just to be a 1 week message, but then as I started just excavating what the Holy Spirit was revealing, it may be 2, maybe 3 weeks. So let's see what God does as we unpack this message today. And today's title of the message, in light of emotional health, is The Unsustainable Pace. Now, when you think about unsustainable pace, can you relate to some of these questions? Are you overworked, overcommitted, and overwhelmed? Or maybe you have the too much problem, too many demands, too many choices, too many things on the calendar, you have too many distractions, and too many people vying for your attention. If that's you, this message is for you, okay? And I'm gonna be totally transparent in this message that was me. I was operating in this unsustainable pace, and yet you might be saying the same thing, but Daniel, that's called life. And you know what? That's what I did. I was feeling overworked, overcommitted, and overwhelmed, and yet I said, this is the normal life. And what I ended up doing as a result of that was trying to operate at a pace of life that was unsustainable. And I'm here to share with you that you don't have to live the rest of your life that way. If you've been going through life that way and just crashing into bed or waiting for you to get sick or go to the hospital just to reset, I'm letting you know right now, you don't have to live the rest of your life that way anymore. And so if you can identify with some of these things, this message is definitely for you. And just to personalize it for you, for me, I was waking up early in the morning tired. Every single morning, I was trying to juggle work and family life all the way through the day into the night, go to meetings at night. After the meetings at night, I would prepare for the next day's meetings or sermons. I would go to bed at 12, 1, 2 o'clock in the morning, exhausted, just falling into bed, only to wake up 4 to 5 hours later, right? Now, you might be saying that sounds crazy, but think about your life. Are you going in that pace of life? Because if you are, I'm letting you know that is unsustainable. Now, the reality is for me, I was doing that for the last 2 years, even before COVID happened. But when COVID happened, everything ramped up. And as a result of that, what I was doing was I was medicating myself. Yes, I use the word medicate because as a result of trying to operate at this pace of life, I was not addressing the stress and anxiety that was pent up over time. And so I was medicating myself with caffeine. Yes, something that seems so seemingly innocent, which we all love. I love a smell of cup of coffee, right? I mean, Scott had coffee in here today, and I was like, oh, I love that smell, right? Starts off really innocent, but for me, I'm kind of like, I'm prophet by personality, so I'm very extreme. So when I got a hold of coffee, when I got a hold of caffeine, by the height of where I was at the unsustainable pace, I was drinking about 630 milligrams of caffeine a day. What is that equal to? That equals to 5 cups of coffee and an energy drink. Okay, now you might be laughing at yourself like, that's crazy, but have you actually measured how much milligrams of caffeine you're taking in every day? Okay, so just be thinking about that as I'm sharing this with you before you're in shock right now, as you well know, you're like, well, that's probably why all these things happen to you, Pastor Daniel. And yes, it's true. What caffeine was doing for me though, it wasn't making me super addicted or hyper. What it was doing was it was actually calming my nerves. I would drink caffeine throughout the day, even to the end of the day, and I would fall asleep with caffeine. Isn't that crazy? I would drink a cup of coffee and I could fall asleep right away. You can ask my wife. That's how addicted I was in some ways to the effect of caffeine, that it really calmed me. Well, there's not enough caffeine to go around in the day to keep the lid on over stress and anxiety. And eventually that lid came off. All the anxiety and stress just burst out one day. And it was actually 1 week after my 37th birthday. I had just finished giving my son Ben a bath. We were getting ready to sit down to eat dinner. And I felt my heartbeat go really fast. And I'm gonna show you a picture here in a little bit. For the month of August, you can see there's about there's 30 days that shows how my heart rate goes beats per minute based on my Apple Watch. I thought my Apple Watch was broken because my range of heart rate was 37 to 198 beats per minute, okay, in a month's time. And 21 out of 30 days, my heart rate was over 100 beats per minute. That's not normal. A normal heartbeat should be between 50 and 100 beats per minute. So some of you are like, wow, 37, you're about to die. No, I have something that just has a slow heart rate. Nothing's wrong with that. But going above 100, 198, that's a problem. And I was operating that way for the last 2 months. And so after giving my son Ben a bath, my heart said, enough is enough. And so my heart started racing. I had chest pain. My hands were tingly and sweaty. And my head felt really light. I was feeling really lightheaded. And so we sat down to dinner. And this is how ridiculous I was in terms of being overworked. I told my wife, I'm not feeling well. She said, well, maybe you should go lie down. I said, well, this in my head at the time, it sounded fine. I said, well, I'm either going to go to my meeting and power through, or I'm going to the hospital. And she's like, hospital, what are you talking about? So she was being a powerful person at that time. And she said, either I'm taking you to the hospital or your dad's taking you to the hospital. And so, of course, Aaron taking care of the kids. My dad drove up. He took me to the hospital. We went to the emergency room. You can see a picture there of me being in the emergency room where I had chest x-rays done. I had a chest ultrasound done. I had an EKG done. They did, I mean, all kinds of tests on me. And it was crazy in just going through all those tests, only to find out that, praise God, I didn't have a heart attack. But at the same time, we didn't know what was wrong. And for the days that would follow after the emergency room, it was some of the darkest days of my life. When I was asleep, I was having these demonic encounters, these horrible dreams in which I was being killed or one of my family members was being killed. So horrible, horrible dreams. And when I was awake, it wasn't much better because I felt like a zombie. I felt like I was in the Twilight Zone. I was awake, but I wasn't really awake. I was with my wife, but I couldn't engage. I was with my kids, but I wasn't present with them. And whenever I'd go to sleep, I would cry myself to sleep every single time. Because I felt hopeless. I would cry out to the Lord, God, you got to reset my body. You got to change what's going on. And I came to the point in my life where I didn't know what was going to happen. And I said to myself, this is how the rest of my life is going to be from this point on. And it was a really sad awakening at that time. And so my dad had been calling me every day and praying for me. And he had discerned that it was stress related, but I didn't think it was stress, honestly. I just thought something's wrong with my heart. I don't have stress out. I don't have anxiety. I'm not worried about dying. I'm not worried about any of these things. I'm getting these demonic encounters, but I'm not feeling that way. And so he said, I don't know what's going on, but I really feel like, Daniel, it's stress related. Anyway, he called on the big guns. He asked for the prayer warriors to pray for all of us. And one of them being my spiritual grandfather, Ed Savoso. And I'm just so thankful for Ed and Ruth. They love us so much. And he told my dad, tell Daniel to call me right away. I know exactly what he's going through. And those are the words that brought so much healing, so much strength, and so much stability in my life. During those dark days of feeling chest pain, feeling my heart rate accelerated, and feeling hopeless and broken, and I couldn't be present when I was awake, and I didn't want to sleep because I was getting these horrible nightmares. And so when I called Ed, he said, Daniel, I know exactly what you're going through. Everything you're going through now, I went through. Now, this is not an Ed Savoso testimony, so I'm not going to bare his story to you. That's his choice. He wants to share his personal journey with you. I believe one day he will because it was so inspiring and so empowering. But in short, he said, there's three things that I want you to take away from this meeting, Daniel. And I want you to pay attention to the spiritual, the emotional, and the physical. And he broke it down into three categories in identifying these different areas of my life that needed to be addressed. And so with the spiritual, he addressed the demonic, which, like I was having these demonic encounters, he had those demonic encounters at one point in his life. And so what he said to me at this point was he said, because this is spiritual and demonic, you need to do two things. The first thing you need to do is you need to pray in the Spirit. I don't know where you're at. I don't know if you've ever learned or prayed in the Spirit before, but the Bible calls it tongues. And every morning I would wake up and I would pray in the Spirit. And, you know, with my Apple Watch, I could literally look at my heart rate. My heart rate would go up to 80, 90 beats per minute. And I would just start praying in the Spirit. I would either sit down or lie down. And immediately my heart rate would go back down to 40 to 50 beats per minute. Like immediately, okay? Like that's how powerful this thing is when you pray in the Spirit. So he said, pray in the Spirit whenever you get these heart palpitations. Pray in the Spirit when you wake up. You want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. In fact, you want his oil to be poured upon you. And he was making a reference to Psalm 23, where David is calling out to God like a shepherd and David being a sheep. And he says, you anoint my head with oil. And as a reference to the nose fly, this is kind of nasty and crass, but the nose fly would go through the sheep's nose and burrow its way into the brain, causing the sheep to go crazy. Well, in short, that's what was happening with me. The spirit of death was coming against me and burrowing its way into my spiritual nose and into my brain and causing me to go crazy when I was asleep and when I was awake. In fact, one of our intercessors, our main intercessor, Kathy Kong, when she was praying for me while I was at the hospital, she said to me, I felt like there was some kind of bug, some kind of spiritual thing trying to burrow its way into your brain. And I was like, that's confirmation, Ed. That's exactly what's been happening. He's like, hey, that's the first thing, pray in the Spirit. The second thing you need to do is you need to stand up and resist the devil. You need to come against the spirit of death, and you need to declare that your life is in the hands of Jesus. Revelation 1:18, that Jesus holds in his hands death and sin in his hands. It's the keys that he has authority over, not the devil. And so I said that in the name of Jesus. Devil, you have no control over my life. I'm in the hands of Jesus Christ. He holds my life in his hands. You don't hold my life in your hands. And I tell you what, from that day on, all the demonic encounters stopped. If you're having night terrors, you're having these demonic encounters when you're sleeping, I want you to do that. I want you to pray the power of Revelation 1:18, that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, holds our lives in his hands. So that's addressing the spiritual. The emotional, this is especially for you guys. Ed said, you need to learn to cry. Okay, now some of you might know me that when I preach, I oftentimes cry. I just did a little bit a little while ago. But you know, when I'm with people, I rarely cry, to be honest with you. And he said, Daniel, you need to learn to tap into your soul and just grieve. Grieve the loss of all the individuals that you've lost this year. Grieve the battles that you fought for, but you were defeated in the last 2 years. Grieve the hardships that you endured personally and as a family and as a pastor. I want you to just grieve all that out. Cry. I want you to learn to cry. And when he said that, something broke in me. I said, you know, Ed, I for some reason, I just can't do it. You got to pray for me. And so my spiritual grandfather, Ed Savoso, I've never seen him cry before, but he prayed for me, a release for me to just break open emotionally and start crying. And I tell you what, the floodgates opened and healing. I literally felt my heart feel better. All the anxiety and stress started getting flushed out of me as I was praying, as he was praying for me. And I was crying these tears, these alligator tears just coming out. And he said, that's what you need to do all the time, Daniel. A true man cries. And I'm sure you've heard that before, but maybe you need to be reminded of that, especially for you men and women, that it's okay and good for you to cry and release the tears, release the emotional pain. The third thing was the physical. He said, you know, Daniel, I know that you think that you can live your life this way, but you are coming to an age now where you can't just go through it. You can't just ramble your way through it. You can't just eat fast food. You can't just take more caffeine in it. You have to stop and you have to take into account your family. You have to take into account your people, and you're responsible for your health to these people. And so I stopped, obviously, drinking 630 milligrams of caffeine a day. In fact, I'm drinking tea now, at best green tea, maybe once every other day, okay? So I'm not even getting close to the kind of caffeine I was taking. I've totally cleaned up my diet. I'm seeing my PCP. I'm seeing a cardiologist. I'm cleaning up my act as I've taken care of the physical aspect of my life. And I'll show you a picture. Took a screenshot of it yesterday. Remember from last month in August, the month of August, majority of the month, my heartbeats were over 100 beats per minute throughout the month. Well, just yesterday, my heartbeat didn't even go above 100 beats per minute. Okay, so that is a reflection of the spiritual, of the emotional and the physical accumulating all together and partnering with the Lord. And I want to say this to you, that as you're hearing this message, you might be feeling convicted right now, but you don't know how to stop the unsustainable pace that you call normal, but you're feeling overworked. You're feeling overcommitted and you're feeling overwhelmed. And you can't wait to put your head on that pillow every night because you're just wanting it to stop, but you know very well that you're gonna wake up in 4 to 5 hours the next day, only to continue that crazy cycle of living. I wanna say to you that there is a better way. And I'll share all the details next week or the next time I talk about this. You don't have to live in the unsustainable pace. You can live in the unstoppable pace. That God has it in His Word, where He's written into His code that you can live the unstoppable way along with the force of the Holy Spirit, as I've learned to take on in order to take care of my emotional health, my family's emotional health, and your emotional health. In fact, right now, if you can identify with me right now, I want to pray for you. I want to pray that the unsustainable pace stops for you right now. And so, Holy Spirit, we just come before you. And Lord, we pray, God, that you would minister to my family right now. Minister to my friend right now. Minister to this person that is listening to my words, that you would speak to him or her exactly what they need to hear. Lord, that nobody likes to hear you need to slow down, but in saying that, Lord God, you're causing them to slow down so that they can pay attention to the things you want them to see, so that they can live the unstoppable life that which we'll be sharing in a week or two from now. But Lord, I pray that in order for them to get there, they have to stop living the unsustainable pace of life. And so Holy Spirit, only by your Spirit, only by your conviction can you do that, Lord. And so would you speak to each person, Lord, right now. I speak peace right now over every person. And Lord, that you'd melt away all the anxiety, all the stress, Lord, that's been pent up and building up, Lord. It would all melt away in your presence, Lord, and that you would fill every person with your love, with your authority, with your grace, Lord, that everything that they will do will not be by the pressures of life, not by the performances they do, but by your grace that you give to them. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I hope that you are blessed today. I hope that this ministered to you today. And again, we've been saying this for the last couple weeks, that the online version is an abbreviated version of the message in which we give on the podcast in the in-person services. So I want to encourage you right now, if you can totally identify with this message, share it, like it and share it. But also, I would encourage you, come to our in-person service. Come and be a part of what God is doing as we're diving into this emotional health so that we can live the unstoppable pace that God created us to live for. I love you so much. God bless you guys.
Wow, wasn't that an awesome message by our Pastor Daniel? And now, here's our announcements.
Our first announcement, save the date, October 16th, our TLCs, Transformation Living Classes. It's going to be awesome. Pastor Marion's getting it all together. More information will come. Put it on your calendar, October 16th, TLCs. Anything else?
Yes, we want to thank all of you who came out and donated food and also monetary gifts for our food drive. We are so truly blessed, and our community is truly blessed. So once again, thank you so much for just your giving. We appreciate it.
So good. And right now, Pastor Daniel has a very special announcement just for all of you. Check it out.
Hey everyone, I just want to talk to you about our tithes and offerings announcement. In fact, I'll be giving the tithes and offerings announcement for the next several weeks. And so I just wanted to share with you, I mean, Michaela and Scott have been doing a great job. Uncle Ron and Auntie Dale have been doing a fantastic job. And so I'm just here to add to what they're saying. And I just want to say, hey guys, when you tithe and you give, it's directly connected to our faith. And this is a time where we have to live by faith. In fact, when I was in Argentina, oh man, almost 19 years ago, we were staying with a family, and we were getting up early in the morning, and you know, we would just eat croissants and orange juice every morning. And so the mother of the family said, hey Daniel, go get the orange juice from the fridge. I opened the fridge up, and there is one bottle of orange juice and a couple of condiments in the refrigerator. I kid you not, that's exactly all that was in the refrigerator. And this family was choosing to house four of us teenagers in their house, and they were giving, they're churchgoers, and they were faithful members of the congregation, and they were taking us in. And this is a time, guys, where we measure our faith by our tithing, by our giving. And in fact, those of us who tithe, we say, yeah, of course we want to tithe. We've seen the benefits of it. And I'm not just talking about financial benefits. I'm actually talking about relational and spiritual benefits as well. That as you step out in faith, I want to call you to that. Take that another step of faith. Maybe you started tithing in the beginning of the year. Get back on the horse. Get started. Maybe you're trying to build up to 10%. That's awesome. Go and do that. Or maybe you're just struggling to tithe consistently, and I want to call you to start tithing consistently, because when you do that, you see the favor of God in all kinds of ways, and your faith level rises as well with your giving. In fact, my kids oftentimes say, hey dad, here's my tithe. I'm like, awesome. And Caleb will oftentimes say, wait, that's not enough. I want to give more. And I'm like, wow, okay. He's like, yeah, because God has always been good to me. And so I want to encourage you, if God has been good to you, yeah, go beyond the 10%. There's nothing against the Bible like that. In fact, God says, in the one area we can test him is with our finances. We can test him with our finances with that. And so with that in mind, before I start preaching, I want to remind you the three ways you can give. The first one is online. It's so easy to do. Go on our website. The second way is you can put it in the mail. Put the check in the mail and we'll receive it at our church property. Or the third way is in person. You come to our church service. We do the offering declaration and we give right after the offering declaration, or you can give at the end of service as well. But either way, let's all step out in faith during this time as we're trusting the Lord. God bless you.
Wow, thank you, Pastor Daniel, for that important announcement. Anything else?
Nope, that's a wrap. Ahui ho and malama pono
from Kaneohe.